The use of cars in our cities is a bit of a hot topic at the moment. There's talk of road pricing and tax breaks for small wheels. In a world of bus lanes and cycle paths, the days of gas-guzzling gridlock are numbered. So perhaps it's time to give the car a bit of a rethink. If it's to stay on our urban streets, it's got to be smaller, lighter, greener, smarter. Marketing gimmick, anyone? These images were part of the pre-launch promotion to hype up the smallest car to come from one of the world's largest manufacturers. Called Smart, this two-seater city car has been built by Mercedes-Benz in conjunction with watchmaker Swatch, who took the idea of its interchangeable wristwear and put them to use in the Smart. If you get fed up with looking at those red panels, you can pop down to the local dealer and have yellow ones fitted instead, or white for that matter. Designed primarily for use around town, its size is its best asset, being 20 inches shorter than a Mini. However, a Mini has room for four, but it doesn't have such a funky interior. Again, thanks to Swatch, most of the coloured bits are swappable, even the clock and rev counter. It may look a little over-designed in some areas, though. This contraption actually holds cassettes and CDs. And the seats seem to be made from an old string vest, but they are surprisingly comfortable and well-ventilated. Round the back, there's room for a little shopping on top of the engine. The motor's a Tiddler, a 600cc three-cylinder, but it is turbocharged, not that you'd know it, and carries the only Mercedes badge to be found on the car. Ours came with a registration just for us. On the move, it doesn't feel small. You're not aware of the back door being just inches behind you. Though for a car that's designed to spend much of its life squeezing in and out of spaces, the three-quarter visibility is pretty dire. Still, there's enough room for two Clarksons to travel in comfort. They wouldn't want to, though, because the fun stops here. If only it went as good as it looked, but the minute you start the Smart, it all goes wrong. All the elements are right, a good driving position and a race-like sequential gear shift, for example, but the box jerks at every change unless you lift off the gas, in which case you might as well have a traditional manual. And you'll be working your way through the gears all the time just to keep up with traffic. The 55 brake horsepower engine ought to give better performance in a car this size. Top speed is 84 miles an hour, and you'll have to take a week off work to get there. No car needs to be this sluggish. The biggest disappointment is the steering and handling. The non-assisted wheel needs a full turn to get round just a 90 degree bend, and then there's bags of understeer. A Mini Cooper it is not. It isn't as agile as it should be. Problems with the Mercedes A-Class rolling over set alarm bells ringing in the Smart camp, so they made the wheelbase longer for better stability. They also made it understeer at the slightest sniff of a bend, causing those skinny front tires to scrabble for grip. All that hard work doesn't help the fuel economy, which is only marginally better than Ford's Ka. It's on sale in the rest of Europe now and may come to Britain before the millennium, but at almost £6,000, it is an expensive two-seater and not worth the wait. I really want to love the Smart, but I can't. The concept, styling and details are fantastic, and it's a refreshing change from mainstream motors. It's convincingly cool and you don't look too silly in it. But it's the driving experience that lets it down. Small cars should be fun to drive as well as look at, and the Smart is a long way behind Ford's Ka and Rover's 39-year-old Mini. Cars of the future may look like this, but they ought to perform a darn sight better.